This week on WealthTrack, are they demons or angels? Raiders or protectors? Hedge funds have been called a lot of names, but what impact are these huge investment funds having on the financial markets and your portfolio? Everything you need to know about hedge funds is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. How much do you know about hedge funds? How much should you know about them for financial self-preservation? Well, these enormous hidden pools of money, the domain of institutional investors and wealthy individuals, are our focus this week. They've been making headlines for the fortunes their managers make and the billions their investors can lose when their bets prove wrong, as some of them have been doing recently in energy and subprime mortgages. Well, hedge funds are everything mutual funds are not. They are private, not public. They are unregulated, not regulated. They can invest anywhere in anything. Mutual funds have strict investment guidelines. Hedge funds can short stocks, betting that they go down, not just buy and hold. They can borrow as much money as their lenders will let them, and they borrow a lot. Mutual funds cannot leverage up. The so-called hedge funds for wealthy and sophisticated investors have been around for decades, but they did not become a formidable market force until the 90s. In 1990, there were about 610 of them with around $39 billion under management. Today, there are more than 9,000 of them worldwide, managing more than $1.5 trillion. And as our guests will tell you, that isn't even close to estimating their market reach. The funds borrow 5 to 10 times or more the amount of money they manage to buy more securities. And it is that leverage and how hedge funds use it that is of particular concern to government officials around the world. Wall Street has created trillions of dollars worth of complex trading strategies and securities called derivatives, which hedge funds invest in. They have already caused the downfall of several funds. It's estimated hedge funds are responsible for 40% of all U.S. stock trading and more than 50% of all U.S. bond trading. They make fortunes for the investment firms that serve them, an estimated $50 billion a year in fees and interest for investment banks on Wall Street and London alone. And the personal fortunes being amassed by the top hedge fund managers are staggering. Last year, the 25 highest paid managers earned more than $14 billion as a group. The top three each earned more than $1 billion. Are these mighty funds a threat to the markets and investors, or the creators of unprecedented wealth and prosperity? The answers are next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack. What should you know about the impact hedge funds are having on the financial markets? What, if anything, should you be doing differently with your investments because of their enormous influence? Well, joining us are two guests with years of firsthand experience in the field. PhD economist Richard Bookstaber has worked at several of Wall Street's largest hedge funds, overseen risk management at Solomon Brothers, and has created some of the complex securities he is warning about in his new book. It is called A Demon of Our Own Design, Markets, Hedge Funds, and the Perils of Financial Innovation, and it is causing quite a stir on Wall Street. Our other guest is also a PhD economist, is multitasking professionally. Among many other things, he is a visiting scholar at the think tank American Enterprise Institute, where he is studying the role of hedge funds on the capital markets. And he is an economics professor at Carnegie Mellon. But Adam Lerrick also spent years as an investment banker, first at Solomon Brothers and several other firms, where he specialized in new product development. So welcome to both of you.
Thank you, Consuelo.
You know, a lot of us are clueless as to, we hear about hedge funds, but we really don't know what they are. I tried to describe kind of what they're not and some of what they are in the opening remarks. But, you know, what is a hedge fund? How would I know, you know, a hedge fund versus a private equity fund or any other, you know, fund that's privately managed?
That's right. It would be very hard for you to distinguish them. A hedge fund is simply a pool of money that can invest anywhere in the world and where the management compensation structure is such that the managers receive a large percentage of the profits as compensation.
So that's the 2 in 20, right?
That's the 2 in 20. And it's not only the classic rule is 2 in 20, where they receive a fixed fee of 2% of assets under management plus 20% of the profits. But some of the hedge funds have now reached the 3 in 30, the 4 in 40, and even the 5 in 50%, where they receive 50% of the profits.
So Richard, why are they so popular? I mean, why is it that suddenly in the 1990s we've seen an explosion of these funds?
Well, one reason is, the fact that the compensation is richer.
Right.
So talent tends to flow to where the compensation's higher. And the other reason is that they're not as constrained as other funds. As you pointed out, they can go short as well as long. So they can bet on stocks or markets that might go down. They can lever so that if they think there's an opportunity, they can double up and make more money if they're right, and obviously lose more if they're wrong. And they're not as constrained in the assets that they can go into. They can go into emerging markets. They can use all sorts of innovative derivative instruments. So if you have the combination of a compensation structure that leads the more talented people to move into that area, and once they're there, they have more freedom in how they invest, you have a recipe for a very popular and thriving market.
Right. So let me ask you each, because the question on the table is what impact the hedge funds are having now on the financial markets that have had, to date, and then the next part of that is what impact you think they're going to have on the financial markets. So Adam Lerrick, we showed 40% of U.S. stock trading, 50% of U.S. bond trading. What's happened in those markets because of hedge funds that would not have happened without their enormous presence?
Well, without their enormous, as you said, Consuelo, they now dominate trading
right.
in almost all the arenas. And in addition to bonds and stocks, they're the key players in currency markets, in emerging market bond markets, in distressed debt markets, in the commodities markets. And what they're doing is this is one of the key issues, what does a hedge fund do? A hedge fund is basically searching the world for the highest absolute return. And they don't care whether they're trading pork bellies or Malaysian ringgits or US Treasury bonds. They just are looking for, in theory, temporary aberrations in prices where they can sort of seize the discrepancy, profit by it, and capture it and bring it home. And what does that mean for the markets? It means that you're now having hedge funds setting the prices in the markets. They are what we call in economics the marginal price setters. And that has extraordinary ramifications both for investors and for policymakers. I mean, if you're Ben Bernanke and you're trying to figure out how to guide the economy and how to guide monetary policy, one of the key pieces of information you use are prices of assets. And the price of an asset is very different when it's being set by a hedge fund, which is looking at a short-term trading strategy, an arbitrage opportunity, as opposed to a long-term investor who is only long, a long-only fund, who's thinking, well, this is an asset that I think is going to appreciate over time. The hedge fund could be setting the price not because he believes this is an attractive investment in itself. He may not even know what the investment is. His computer model is just picking that asset out of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of assets around the world, saying this price is going to move in this direction based on some correlation with a series of other assets on the other side of the world. And he doesn't know that it's investing in toll roads in Indiana, or it's investing in U.S. Treasury bonds, or it's investing in defaulted securities of Argentina.
So it's so interesting, because one of the things that you had told me when you and I had talked earlier was that, the old adage used to be kind of follow the money. If you follow what, a company that Carl Icahn is investing in, for instance, or Warren Buffett or whatever, you're going to make money. But in this case, you just said following hedge funds where they're going doesn't necessarily mean it's a good investment.
Not necessarily. It
right.
may mean temporarily it's a good investment.
That day.
Or right. that nanosecond.
Right.
In essence, hedge funds trade based on fractions of seconds. They don't base it's the short term is not. When I was at Solomon Brothers, we used to joke the short term is next week. For a hedge fund, the short term is measured in milliseconds.
All right. So, Richard Bookstaber, what difference has this kind of trading made, do you think, on the values of assets? Yeah. If they're setting the marginal price of an asset, what difference are they making in the markets?
One positive difference they make in the market, which Bernanke's mentioned, is they do add liquidity into the market.
And that means money, right?
Yeah, that means that if I want to sell or buy an asset, I probably don't have to move the market as far to do it as I would if there weren't hedge funds there as on the other side of the market. So, for the individual investor trying to get in or out of a trade, there's now more people sitting there focused on the stock who are ready to take the other side.
Okay.
And that leads possibly to lower volatility day by day in the market. We certainly have seen.
Which we've seen, yeah. Right, for the last several years.
Yeah, now the cause and effect is still not completely clear, but it could well be that having more liquidity through the hedge funds leads to lower volatility because prices don't have to move as much for somebody to take the other side. The problem is that what you see day by day in volatility doesn't necessarily map to what could occur in the case of crises. And we can get into that a little later. The one point, though, I want to make, though, with hedge funds is there are hedge funds that are very short-term mm-hmm. in their orientation. And they're called stat-arb funds, usually, or high-frequency trading funds. But a lot of hedge funds in the equity space are similar in their approach to how they trade to what you would see with mutual funds, in the sense that they're value-oriented. The difference, though, is that when they find value, they can buy more than one-to-one, and if they find negative value, they can short. So part of what's going on with hedge funds is sort of a displacement of what's done typically by mutual funds. They're in the same game, but they really have more tools at their disposal, and because of the fee structure that they have, a lot of the better people will naturally migrate to them. So I think you also have direct competition to mutual funds.
Oh, that's interesting. So I know that there's been a talent drain, right, of kind of the best and the brightest now certainly coming out of business schools or going into hedge funds
yeah.
rather than mutual funds. So longer term, that might not have a great effect on individual
yeah.
investors investing in mutual funds possibly,
yeah.
but that might be a stretch.
Well, or what you may find, and we're seeing this with some strategies that are occurring with mutual funds, what you may find is that the mutual fund industry adapts. There's a type of fund now, what's called, the typical name for it is 130-30, where what you do is you go long 130% and short, you can go short up to 30%, as opposed to a typical mutual fund, which is just long 100%. Well, a 130-30 strategy can go short up to 30%, which
right.
often is more than enough, and it's levered because its net, its gross exposure is more than 100%. So insofar as you find mutual funds or long-only funds migrating to the 130-30 type of strategies, they're moving more into the hedge fund space. And so
So you think we're going to see more mutual funds that are going to be like hedge fund-like?
Yeah, I think they almost have to because, as you're pointing out, if they don't do that, they're behind the game.
Right.
In terms of incentive fees, in terms of the tools they have at their disposal to trade. So 5 years from now, I don't know that what we'll see are hedge funds and mutual funds.
Mm-hmm.
I think we may see sort of a melding of the two.
So let me ask you as well about this $1.5 trillion in assets that I mentioned at the opening of the program. And the fact that when people talk about hedge funds, and certainly recently where we've had a couple of hedge funds at Bear Stearns being dissolved, that they talk about leverage. So explain how that works and why many government officials around the world are concerned about the borrowing that hedge funds are doing.
I think that's the main concern of governments. I mean, governments have two concerns about financial markets. One is investor protection of the unsophisticated investor. And their hedge funds are really not a major issue because to access a hedge fund directly, mm-hmm. you need to be basically what the SEC calls a high net worth individual, a sophisticated investor. The other issue is, how do hedge fund activities or any investment activity affect the stability of the financial system? And there the concern is really about leverage, because if you have a fund that, or an investor that buys $100 million of bonds with $100 million of cash, well, if the price of the bonds falls from 100 to 90, they will lose 10% of their money, but there's no trigger. There's not like a margin call that they suddenly have to liquidate in order to reach their margin. But if the same investor buys $100 million of bonds with $2 million of cash and borrows $98 million from his banker or his investment bank, then, well, if the bonds fall by 3 points, suddenly that collateral is going to be seized and it's going to be sold. And so suddenly onto the market will come $100 million of bonds. And that's what they're worried about.
And that's been happening in the subprime mortgage market. And an analogous situation for an individual would be the high-risk mortgages. You put up just a little bit, and you basically borrow a ton. And then, right, if the value of your asset goes down, you know, you've got to put up more equity.
That's right. And that's the question. And you touched upon it earlier, Consuelo, when you said, well, do they provide liquidity? And it's the same thing. Well, this is the big debate. Certainly in good times, hedge funds provide a huge amount of liquidity. They're there, small changes in prices, they come running in and buy or sell to minimize the volatility. The question is, what's going to happen in a crisis? Because you don't really care about liquidity if you're a policymaker or really an investor. In good times, you care about it in a crisis. And there is a debate, and it's an unanswered question, because as absolute rate of return investors, investors that don't care whether the market's going up or the market's going down, they just want to get the highest absolute economic return. In theory, they will be a stabilizing force because they will go against the trend. An index fund always, if the market's falling, an index fund sells. And that just continues the trend downward.
But it's not tested yet,
It's not tested because the other possibility is that when the crisis comes, the hedge funds, either themselves or their lenders, when prices start falling, will liquidate their holdings on a massive scale, exacerbating the crisis.
Right. And this is where you come in, because in your book, A Demon of Our Own Design, Markets, Hedge Funds, and the Perils of Financial Innovation, it's the financial innovations that you said are the problem, and the hedge funds are huge users of it. So explain that, what you're concerned about.
My concern, the leverage is, you know, half of the equation, and derivatives and complex instruments is the other half. I mean, I completely agree that the issue where the risk is in the market comes, and this is why the title of the book is A Demon of Our Own Design, it doesn't come from the economy. If you look at the market crises that have occurred over the last 20 years, they haven't been due to economic events, they've been due to market events. And the two elements of the design of the markets that cause the problems are high leverage and complex instruments. You know, the leverage is an issue because it can force you to liquidate. Even if you know an asset has value, you might have to liquidate it because you have to make good on your borrowing on your loans that you got from the bank. And then you can have what can happen is, as you liquidate, it forces the prices down to where the bank says, hey, remember the collateral that you had? It used to be worth $100 million. Now it's only worth $90 million. You have to make put up more, so you have to sell more and sell more, and you have this liquidity crisis.
So, and this is what happened with Amaranth in the energy space, and this is what happened with the Bear Stearns funds, that they're kind of, they've been working out themselves. But
and those were pretty well contained. But the horror stories that can occur, you have to look a little further back, because those two so far are well contained, to say what happened with LTCM.
Right, long-term capital management.
Right, in 1998, the Russia crisis was the trigger for the problems with LTCM, and LTCM didn't even have exposure in Russia.
All right, so let me just quickly get to, because we've only got a couple of minutes left, is, so, you know, what, how concerned are you that we're gonna have some sort of a financial blow up, and what should investors, individual investors, do to protect themselves?
Well, first of all, I'm not terribly concerned we're going to have a major financial crisis.
Okay.
I think the danger to the financial system lies in ignorance of risks. In essence, markets hate surprises. Surprises are what cause crises. The more information you can give to the market, the less likely you're going to have a crisis,
right,
or you're going to have a surprise.
And there's not a lot of information coming out of hedge funds right now. You think there should be more?
I think what should be is that what should happen is we need to know, when I say we, policymakers,
right,
and investors, need to know the amount of leverage in the system, the concentrations of the positions, the concentrations of exposures. And then once you know those potential risks, investors and policymakers can take action, precautionary action. So if one of those risks actually materializes, the crisis will be far less severe.
All right. We're not there yet. Not even close.
We're not there yet.
Yeah. So, do you think that's a solution as well?
I think...
Bookstaber?
Yeah. Having the information is sort of risk management 101.
Yeah.
And
but
right
we don't
now,
have it.
Yeah, and we don't have it. And what you do after you have the information is another issue. One of the problems I see with the approach to regulation right now, and is sort of the end point of my book, is that the tendency is to wait until the risk occurs and then figure out, oh, we have high leverage, what should we do about it?
Right.
Or, oh, we have a lot of complex instruments out there that, and we can't really understand how they may react, what should we do about it? I think it's critical for regulators to get ahead of the game and say, we're going to control the amount of complexity in the market. We're going to control the type of derivatives that are issued. We're going to control leverage. We're not going to let leverage go as high as the broker-dealers or investment banks are willing to if we think there are negative externalities to it. Now, how that gets done is a difficult question, and I think maybe I'm smart enough to stop before you get to that point, but I think somehow it has to be done that
way. All right. Most important thing an individual investor can do to protect his or herself in the event that there is some sort of a blow-up in the financial system. One thing we could do.
An individual? Well, the question is if there is a blow-up, obviously if you can be one of the first ones out, you certainly should liquidate everything. On the other hand, individual investors are very seldom the first ones out.
Right.
All right. And so what you really should think about is that what type of asset should I own in good times and bad times that over the long haul is going to serve me well.
And that is?
And I think basically that is having a diversified equity portfolio, meaning having an equity fund, let's say an index equity fund that would focus on the U.S. stocks,
okay,
and then another similar holding and one that focuses on international stocks,
right,
both in industrialized countries and in emerging markets.
And that's basically your one investment for a long-term diversified portfolio. And Morningstar, you don't recommend funds, but Morningstar has recommended two that Vanguard puts up because they're very low cost, and there's an international fund and a domestic fund. And you basically, it's so interesting, Richard, you have the same type of approach that to be really extremely well diversified essential in stocks.
Right. I would say, first of all, an individual investor is in a great situation when we talk about crises and hedge funds, because an individual investor typically is not levered in terms of their equity portfolio, so they can wait out a crisis.
All right. And so hold.
So hold. I think usually a liquidity crisis, and there can be exceptions to this, but typically liquidity-driven crises, that is crises that come due to leverage, wash over once everything has been worked out. So if you're an individual investor, the main point is look at the long term and don't panic.
Buy and hold. Well, we're going to leave it there, and I look forward to having you both back again, because the hedge fund world and certainly the demons of our own design, all these financial innovations, are going to be with us for a long time and could cause us some problems and opportunities. Richard Bookstaber, and the author of A Demon of Our Own Design, thank you very much for being with
it's
us.
My pleasure.
And Adam Lerrick, we appreciate your being here as well from Carnegie Mellon.
My pleasure, Consuelo.
Well, at the conclusion of every Wealth Track, we give you one suggestion to help you build or protect your wealth over the long term as well. And in this case, it's about a relatively new kind of investment you might actually want to avoid. This week's action point, don't rush into a fund of hedge funds. These so-called funds of funds are now being marketed to less wealthy individual investors, and they raise several issues. First, as numerous studies have proven, chasing yesterday's hot performance has historically been a loser's game, and hedge funds have been hot for several years. Second, as our guest just discussed, the halcyon days of spectacular hedge funds performance are probably behind us. That's something we've heard from many of our guests. There are now too many players trying to do the same thing, and many of the newer entrants lack experience. Third, the biggest and oldest hedge funds with the best long-term records are not participating in these funds of hedge funds directed at the smaller individual investor. And fourth, the high fees involved in investing in multiple hedge funds hurt performance. That's according to Mark Kritzman, a contributor to Peter L. Bernstein, Inc.'s highly regarded newsletter, Economics and Portfolio Strategy. Kritzman and some of his students at MIT Sloan School of Management studied the impact portfolio fees had on investing in baskets of hedge funds and found them to be, quote, unfavorable. And adding the fund-to-fund management fees to the mix weighs the returns down even more. And we are counting down to the close of this edition of WealthTrack. We hope you can join us next week. We're going to have two super smart personal finance guides who are going to share their roadmaps to financial success. The multi-talented Ben Stein and Money Magazine's Jason Zweig will take us on the road to financial freedom. And you should feel free to see this program again starting on Monday. Just go to our website, WealthTrack.com, to view it as a podcast or a streaming video. Until next time, make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.